The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. We're glad that we can worship together with you this morning online. I invite you to download the bulletin, which you can find on the Facebook page and website, or look at it online and share with us in this time of worship together, joining in the singing of hymns and the responsive readings. I invite you to reach out to us online or at other times to let us know how you're engaged in the online worship experience, how that's going for you, things that you think we might be able to do differently or better. We covet your feedback, and your sense of participation with us in this time is very important. I encourage you to reach out to me or Helen or someone else in the church staff if there's something specific that you need, a prayer concern, a phone call that needs to be made. We're really depending upon your input to help us to be able to continue to reach out to our congregation and the community at this time. At some point during this week, please look at the church's webpage or look at the up-to-date that has gone out and make yourself aware of the things that the congregation is still continuing to do to try and be present in the community and be present for one another. It's an important part of our sense of ministry and serving God during this time. One of the things that we're going to do in this upcoming week is continue our collection of food supplies for the Washington Shores Food Pantry. We normally do that on the third Sunday of each month by bringing things here to the sanctuary and then taking them over to Washington Shores Presbyterian Church. But this week, on Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday, we invite you to bring your food supplies for donation to Struble Hall, to the rear door of Struble Hall in the little parking lot at the north end of the building there in between 11 a.m. and 1 p.m. You can either wait in your car and somebody will come pick up your donations from you, take them inside, or you can park and just bring them in and put them down on the table right inside the door. And then at the end of the week, we'll take these donations over to Washington Shores Presbyterian Church. They're working with other churches in the neighborhood in that area to distribute these food items to people in need. So I encourage you to participate with us in this outreach ministry. Let us now prepare to worship God in a time of silent meditation.
Our first reading is from Luke 24, verses 13 through 27. Now on that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" He asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him. Then he said to them, "Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory?" Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Friends, we are called to worship. Let's read responsibly the call to worship you'll find in your bulletin. Lift your voices to God. We call on the one who promises to hear us. In life, in death, in every moment, God deals graciously with us.
We rejoice in the one who saves us.
Lift up the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord.
Gracious is the Lord, and righteous. Our God is merciful. The Lord be praised.
O God, indeed, may your name be praised as we gather here to worship, from our homes, from wherever we may find ourselves, from this holy place. May we all join as one, knit us together as if we were in the same space, so that our voices might rise before you. Guide our time of worship, we pray, in Christ's name. Amen. As you are able, please stand. Please be seated.
Psalm 116. I love the Lord because he has heard my voice and my supplications, because he inclined his ear to me. Therefore, I will call on him as long as I live. The snares of death encompass me. The pangs of Sheol lay hold on me. I suffer distress and anguish. Then I called on the name of the Lord. O Lord, I pray, save my life. Gracious is the Lord and righteous. Our God is merciful. The Lord protects the simple. When I was brought low, he saved me. Return, O my soul, to your rest, for the Lord has dealt bountifully with you. For you have delivered my soul from death, my eyes from tears, my feet from stumbling. I walk before the Lord in the land of the living. I kept my faith even when I said, I am greatly afflicted. I said in my consternation, everyone is a liar. What shall I return to the Lord for all his bounty to me? I will lift up the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his faithful ones. O Lord, I am your servant. I am your servant, the child of your serving girl. You have loosed my bonds. I will offer you a thanksgiving sacrifice and call on the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. In the courts of the house of the Lord, in your midst, O Jerusalem, praise the Lord. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
This word from the psalmist is a testimony of sorts of his own plea and call of to God to hear his prayer, a call of thanksgiving, of recognizing that God is a God of mercy and a God of love. It is with that we come to this time of confession, raising our own pleas before God to hear us, to redeem us, to save us, to heal us. Let's pray together the prayer of confession. Lord God, your love for us is steadfast and ever-present. We confess how easily we take your love for granted. We get caught up in all our daily worries and frustrations and forget you. We get overwhelmed because we live and work like everything depends on us. We confess the despair that comes over us, the spirit of hopelessness that overpowers us when we fail to trust you. Lord, help us to lift up your name every day. Help us to live with praise and thanksgiving for the wonder of your care for us. Help us to let go of our fear and disappointment and open ourselves to your life-giving spirit. Oh God, what a gift to rest in your presence and be able to breathe in the freedom that your mercy gives. Hear our prayer. Amen. How kind our God is to us, full of grace and compassion. God alone rescues our souls from the grips of death, our eyes from weeping, and her feet from stumbling, so that we can once again, in God's presence, walk with confidence and joy. So be at peace. Your sins are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Friends, the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Turn and greet those who worship with you this day with signs of peace. Peace, friends.
Peace.
Okay, parents, you can go get your second cup of coffee now, and I'll have a chat with the kids. Kids, I wanted to talk a little bit about this story from the Bible that we read earlier. This is a story of Luke's gospel. Luke is one of the four gospel writers that tell us the stories of Jesus. And this is the very end of Luke, the very tail end, the 24th chapter. It's the very end. And the ending is this day of Easter, and the day is ending, and two of Jesus' disciples are walking. They're walking away from Jerusalem after having been with the other disciples, grieving Jesus' death. They don't know yet that Jesus has been raised from the dead. They're grieving Jesus' death, and they're walking. And they're walking home. And I love that picture of them walking. When I was thinking of the disciples and them walking, and these two disciples walking, I then pictured, as the scripture says, that Jesus appeared alongside them and was just walking alongside. It's very, seems to me, a very easy walk, a very easy pace. But they're grieving because their friend Jesus has died, and they now don't know what to do. But Jesus is walking alongside them, and they don't know it's Jesus. They don't know it's Jesus. I was thinking of walking. Maybe you're walking these days. I've seen online where James and Claire, they're in the park and they've been walking together. And they go on walks in the afternoon with their mom, Elizabeth, is walking alongside. I love watching those videos of them walking. I heard this week that Jonathan Anyampam got bicycle for his 10th birthday. Happy birthday, Jonathan. So Jonathan's riding this new bike. I know for some of you, because I know where you live, that you have great places to ride a bike. Thomas, you have a great cul-de-sac to ride in, and Shinley and Detweiler, and Aaron, maybe you have a great place to ride your bike as well. Grayson and Finley, not sure, but I hope you're getting outside. And as I thought about these disciples walking, my own walking, your own being outside, and it being Earth Day, I thought about how wherever we are, Jesus comes and walks alongside us. I think that's part of the promise of this scripture, is that wherever we are, Jesus walks alongside us. We might not recognize Jesus. We might not see Jesus. But in this story is the promise that if you're in the park, you're riding your bike, you're walking down the sidewalk, you're with family, you're with friends, we're not so shut in that Jesus can't get to us. And that is the promise and part of this story for us today. That is good news. And it's good news for us. Will you pray with me? Thank you, gracious God, that no matter where we are, you can find us. We are grateful for that. Hear our prayer. Be with us. Amen. Here is the rest of the story from the road to Emmaus, picking up Luke 24, verse 28. Listen for God's word. As they came near the village to which they were going, Jesus walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, "Stay with us, because it is almost evening and the day is now nearly over." So Jesus went in to stay with them. When he was at table with them, he took bread, he blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. And then their eyes were opened. They recognized Jesus, and he vanished from their sight. they said to one another, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking with us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?" That same hour they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, "The Lord has risen, and he has appeared to Simon." And then they told what happened on the road and how Jesus had been made known to them in the breaking of the bread. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Almighty God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O God, who art our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Two disciples, Cleopas and another, were walking on the road home from Jerusalem to Emmaus on the evening of Easter Sunday. They were walking, Luke says, and talking about all these things that had happened. You and I know what that's like. We know what it's like to walk along side by side and talk and question and ponder and wonder about all these things that have happened. The experience of a death in our lives, a momentous occasion, a celebration, something we're trying to hold on to in our memory. But we know what this like is like to walk along and to talk about all these things, just like these disciples are doing. And we know these two disciples are walking home from Jerusalem on Easter Sunday evening, and all these things that have happened are the events that have taken place there in Jerusalem on Monday, Thursday, and Good Friday, and Holy Saturday, and Easter Sunday. I think of the ways that I often talk with Helen about events in our lives, all these things, and think about the ways that we're trying to hold on to them for each other. Just recently, I was engaged in a conversation with Helen, rehearsing and going over again in my mind the events around her dad's death. And I said, "Now, what time did we get that call in the middle of the night? Do you remember we were asleep?" And she said, "Yeah, I think maybe it was about 11:30. "Right, it was 11:30. Woke us up, didn't it?" "Yes, it woke us up. And what did we do next?" "Well, we went back to sleep because we knew he had been taken to the hospital. But what time did you go to the airport and catch that airplane to go to Atlanta?" "Oh, I think it was about 7 o'clock. We got a flight quickly. I got one quickly and went straight." "Right, that's you went to Atlanta. And you got to the hospital, and who was there?" "Well, Helen Tapp was there, and Lewis was there." And the conversation goes back and forth, and we remember each and every little thing that happened across those few days when her dad died. And I realize it's almost like we're trying to hold that for one another, even in some ways as we may be trying to hold each other in the midst of remembering and talking about all these things that have happened. In some way, holding them in reality for us, keeping them close to us, helping us to process them and to think about our lives now. We know what it's like to walk along and talk about all these things that have happened. Luke tells us that as the two disciples are walking, suddenly they're joined by Jesus, and he walks with them, and they don't know who he is. And he asks them, "Well, what are you talking about?" And so they begin to tell him about all these things that they're talking about after they are sort of incredulous that he's the only one who doesn't know all these things. But they share with him all these things that have happened. And it's interesting as you listen to them share with Jesus as they're walking along all the things that have happened, what they're actually doing is in some ways sharing the very core of the gospel story. whether they realize it at this moment or not. But they were accounting the very center of the gospel to Jesus as they walk along. And they're also, we probably imagine, still processing and working through grief, whether they're still wondering and trying to deny what had happened, or whether they're angry, or whether they're bargaining. They're still processing everything that's happened as they talk about all these things. And when they finish, it's very interesting. The conversation shifts, and suddenly it's not the disciples who are talking about all these things, but then it's Jesus talking about all these things to the disciples, but now in the context of the scriptures, in the context of the own stories of their faith. Now he's helping them to piece together and put together an understanding of the stories and an understanding of their experiences and an understanding of the reality that they now find themselves in as they're talking about all these things. And intrigued, after he finishes, the evening grows closer. They invite him to come to their house and join him at table. And as he's there with them at table, you and I know that story so well, we can recount even the events of the story, how Jesus takes bread and blesses it and breaks it before them and shares it with them. And then in that moment of breaking and blessing and sharing, suddenly their eyes are opened and they recognize Jesus there in their midst. Then just as quickly he disappears from their sight, and they get up and they run back to Jerusalem to tell the disciples that Jesus has appeared to them. Again, telling again all these things that have happened, but now with a new and deeper understanding, with a new experience of reality, as Jesus himself has taken these things and shared them with the disciples so that they can see in a new way, experience in a new way, and be open to the gift of his risen presence in a new way. That's an important shift that happens in this story, where all the things that we are holding onto no longer pull us down in despair and defeat, but now these things begin to open us to the wonder of God's work and God's life in our midst. My heart and my imagination have just been captured over the past few days by a story I read in the Orlando Sentinel about a man named Michael Kevin Rethel, who came down with the COVID virus in early April and became very, very sick. And then, I believe by April 4th, he had to be hospitalized. He was in Orlando Health, and his health declined until he soon was put on a ventilator and on life support systems, and was declining very rapidly. His wife was doing all she could to reach out to the larger community, asking if there were anyone that was convalescing from the virus that might have antibodies and that could possibly try the new plasma antibody treatment with him. And she put that out across Facebook, and one of her attorney friends put it out in a larger post on his Facebook page, until a man down in South Florida, who happened also to be friends with the attorney friend of the family here in Orlando, saw his post, and he said, "I saw my friend's post. Usually when we post things to each other on Facebook, we're diametrically opposed in what we're saying, and we're kind of charging sparks off of one another in our conversations, but there was something about this post that caught my attention and caught my heart as I read about what he was asking for. So I picked up the phone in South Florida, and I called him, and I said, "I saw your post." And my attorney friend said, "I don't have time to talk right now. I'm looking for somebody who might be convalescing from the virus and might have the antibodies. It's like trying to look for a needle in the haystack." And he said, James Crocker said to this person on the phone, "I'm your needle in the haystack." And he said, "What?" And then immediately he let him know that he was convalescing and recovering from the virus and had the same blood type as Kevin Rethel here in Orlando. So within 30 minutes, he was on his way from South Florida to Orlando, and over the next couple of days went through this incredible process of trying to get tested and shown that he was negative, and then have his blood withdrawn and the plasma examined and tested, so that eventually on April 8th, his plasma was given to Kevin Rethel in the hospital there. And then over the next 4 days, Kevin Rithel started to improve and started to gradually come out of the coma that he had been in, until his wife posted on April 12th, Easter Sunday, a video in which she said to everybody who was watching, "He's awake. His eyes are open, and he saw us and he heard us." And I was able to say over the phone that the nurses were holding up to them, I was able to say, "Kevin, you've been asleep for a week and it's time for you to wake up. Your family loves you and they've been praying for you. It's Easter Sunday and God is working a miracle." And then she could suddenly see the tears streaming down her husband's cheeks there in the hospital. Well, I guess if you're going to wake up from a coma, Easter Sunday is a pretty good time to do that. It's such a powerful, such an amazing story that it catches my imagination, and it becomes one of these things that I find myself talking about and trying to hold on to and weave into my own understanding and sense of what is going on in the world right now. An important thing that I look to be reminded of how God is at work in people's lives. And as I've thought about this story of Kevin and the way that the plasma for one person could be put into his body and help to restore him to life, I began to hear about and think about the story of Jesus' resurrection and risen life, perhaps in similar terms. And I'm sure it's probably not a completely apt theological analogy, but I wonder if in some way the life and the spirit of the risen Christ, who has passed through death, comes to us and comes into our lives, comes into our very selves, almost like an antibody to despair and to defeat and to discouragement and to hopelessness. And it's Christ's life within us that begins to open us and restore to us the possibility and the hope that we too can live with the fullness of God's love and the fullness of God's care in this world. Maybe these stories of Jesus' resurrection and appearances to the disciples can become the things that we hold on to and hold together and share with each other until they almost become, like, through the work of the Spirit, antibodies in our own lives, at work in our own bodies, helping to restore us to life. Is that possibly what it could mean for us, the announcement, the good news that Jesus Christ is risen from the dead here with us? We hold on to these things. We hold on to these things which Christ himself has given to us to become ways that he is present and at work in our lives. The stories of the gospel, the stories of the experience of the risen Christ in our lives, the stories of our gathering to worship together, of holding up cup and bread and saying, "These are the gifts of God for the people of God, the life of Christ for you and I." We hold on to these things. They become our stories. They become the meaning of reality for us. I read a very interesting article this week by Rabbi Joseph Eitelheit, and he was commenting on this past celebration of Passover for the Easter people for the Jewish people, and how difficult it was to celebrate Passover in social isolation. But nevertheless, people did it, and they did that in the same way that we had Easter Sunday, across Zoom meetings and on the telephone and on Facebook Live in different ways. And he said it was important and it was good to do, but there was something that was very lacking in the experience as well. And what was lacking was the ability to be together, adults and children, and share the stories of their faith together, as the very Passover meal calls them to listen to the children's questions and to remind the children of these things that they talk about, to bring to them the biblical past into their present, so that they can say in their own lives, "Yes, God has rescued us and delivered us from slavery as well." Rabbi Edelheit says this is the whole point of the Seder meal, the Passover celebration, to be shaped and to be formed not only by the ancient stories of the Passover experience itself, but the more modern and current stories of the way the Jewish people have been saved and preserved by God. Those ancient stories come together with modern stories and renew and strengthen and give hope to their faith. And he said that process of storytelling reminded him of a story told by Elie Wiesel, a story in which Elie Wiesel remembers another group of rabbis, and it goes like this. When the great Rabbi Israel Baal Shem Tov saw misfortune threatening the Jews, it was his custom to go into a certain part of the forest and meditate. And there he would light a fire and say a special prayer, and the miracle would be accomplished and the misfortune averted. Later, when his disciple, the celebrated Megid Mezirich, had occasion for the same reason to intercede with heaven, he would go to the same place in the forest and say, "Master of the universe, listen, I do not know how to light the fire, but I'm still able to say the prayer." And again, the miracle would be accomplished. And still later, when Rabbi Sassov, in order to save his people once more, would go into the forest and say, "I do not know how to light the fire. I do not know how to say the prayer, but I know the place, and this must be sufficient." It was sufficient, and the miracle was accomplished. And then it fell to Rabbi Rishin to overcome misfortune. And sitting in his armchair, in his living room, his head in his hands, he spoke to God, "I am unable to light the fire, and I do not know the prayer. I can't even find the place in the forest. All I can do is to tell the story, and this must be sufficient." And it was. We talk about these things. We hold on to these things. We remember these things. We share these things. We're shaped by these things now, not only by our own telling, but by the very telling of the risen Christ in our midst, by the very action of the risen Christ in our presence, inviting us to participate and be a part of his life, to let his Spirit infuse us so that his love would go forth in the world through our own lives. Scott Black Johnson is the pastor of Fifth Avenue Presbyterian Church in New York City, and in his sermon last week, he shared a story of a couple that he knows that live in New Orleans, and the couple's name is Beth and Joe Poe. They're members of the St. Charles Avenue Presbyterian Church in New Orleans. Beth and Joe live in New Orleans, which is a coronavirus hotspot, but they also live in a place there called the Lambeth House. The Lambeth House is a multi-phase retirement care facility that unfortunately over the last number of weeks has lost 28 residents to the virus. Beth and Joe are retired professors from Tulane, and this has been a very difficult and trying time for all the residents of the facility, but especially for Beth and Joe. Beth lives on one side of the facility in their apartment, while Joe, her husband, who suffered a severe stroke a number of years ago, lives in the memory care unit of the facility. But now, every day and for the past number of weeks, Beth has been going to Joe's room, and she would wheel him back to her apartment, and there they would listen together to books on tape, and they would talk, and they would sing together. And the one thing they always did was sing the same German hymn, "Go out, my heart, and seek joy." And since they were both retired professors from Tulane, not only did they sing the hymn, but they wrote their own translation of the German every time they sat down to sing the hymn. They would translate the hymn every time from German into English every single day after Beth had wheeled Joe back to their apartment. Beth says that for Joe, as a result of his stroke, though, every single day was like starting over again from scratch. A few weeks ago, because of the virus and what it was doing there in that facility, the whole of Lambeth House had gone down into lockdown, and people were having to stay in their apartments, and people couldn't go from the memory unit and to the other parts of the building. And Beth could no longer go get Joe and bring him back to her apartment for their daily translation. But then a few weeks ago, the nurses and assistants in the memory unit held up a phone for Joe and Beth to have a video chat each day, but they could only do it for about 20 minutes. And Scott Black Johnson said that he learned from them that what they did in this 20 minutes, that was just about enough time, 20 minutes, to translate one single stanza of their favorite hymn. Go out, my heart, and seek joy. And each time when they finished translating and singing that single stanza, Beth would repeat to Joe three phrases, and she would say them over and over again. I love you, I miss you, I have not abandoned you. Until Joe began to say to Beth, that's your litany. That's your litany for me. I love you, I miss you, I have not abandoned you. We hold on to these things. These things, these words, these gifts, these moments given to us by Christ. They are our litany, our liturgy, our work of love. We pray them together. We say them together. We sing them together. We sang them even this morning. Remember the words of our first hymn. Christ has risen. Shout Hosanna. Raise your spirits from the caverns of despair. Walk with gladness in the morning. See what love can do and dare. Drink the wine of resurrection. Not a servant, but a friend. Jesus is our strong companion. Joy and peace shall never end. Christ has risen, earth and heaven nevermore shall be the same. Break the bread of new creation, where the world is still in pain. Tell its grim demonic chorus, Christ is risen, get you gone. God the first and last is with us. Sing Hosanna, everyone. These things, these are the things. Amen.
Let's pray together. O God of love, perhaps it is we who hear your voice in those words, in that litany, that you say to us, I love you, I miss you, I have not forgotten you. We are your heart, your children. Though broken, you call us blessed and beloved. We hardly understand this life-giving gift of being in you. Whatever the mystery, somehow we have heard your voice or nudge or sensed your presence. Somehow your love has reached the places of deep longing and touched us. Somehow your truth has brightened our path and shown us the way. And your forgiveness has lightened our heavy loads of life's disappointments and tragedies and sorrow. We worship with hope that you hear every prayer and that you know our every hurt. We believe, O God, that you answer us with your persistent presence, your unfaltering encouragement, your powerful endurance. We are a people who are no stranger to suffering. We have absorbed the arbitrary attack of crippling disease or the horrible accident that may have occurred in our families. We have learned the lessons of lost love through death or through failure, and we have come to know the sting of loneliness. We have experienced the tension of financial shortage and the threat of economic collapse. Despite our pain, or in part because of it, we remain hopeful and faithful and grateful for your love. For you have given us much, and you have asked for very little. You have sacrificed the best of what you have so that we might have the fullness of life. You have helped us to find life among ashes, a sprig of hope, something brave and persistent, something that pushes up through dry ground, something that refuses to die, to quit, to let death have the last word. We pray, O God, that in this time of pandemic, you would wake us up to this promise, which is your presence, knowing that you are walking with us and, in fact, that you are leading the way. Hear our prayer, this prayer, those prayers which we are naming in our own hearts. And may they all find fullness as we pray together that prayer which Jesus taught his first disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our worship continues through a time of giving our tithes and our offerings, a time of reflection as well.
He is risen, look at the time.
As you are able to stand, let's affirm our faith. We will be using the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace, both now and forevermore. Amen.